worried about that title, Music for a Found Harmonium, it's because that harmonium you've just seen was found in a backstreet gutter in Kyoto in Japan.
I see all music as part of one thing, which is music, and it's all one. And all these divisions that people use are just a convenience, then they don't actually mean anything. So I tend mentally to not have these categories, and I just see music very black and white. Either it's got it or it hasn't. Yeah, and it's right, very, very simple.
The right stuff.
Most of you know, but just for those of you who don't know, ukulele is Hawaiian for dancing fleas. That's what ukulele means. It means dancing fleas. And the next piece is called The Ecstasy of Dancing Fleas.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
The South Bank Show looks at one of the most original musical ensembles in Britain, the Penguin Cafe Orchestra. Their music's almost unclassifiable. It draws on classical and avant-garde elements, as well as pop and ethnic forms. Yet it's distinctively and quirkily English. The orchestra are perhaps best described as reflecting the many musical interests and talents of its founder, Simon Jeffs. He trained as a classical guitarist, yet he's also produced pop groups and arranged the strings on Sid Vicious's notorious version of My Way. Jeff's own compositions have been inspired by enthusiasms which range from Beethoven and Aaron Copland to Madagascan Zilla music and Cajun. The other members of Penguin Cafe have equally diverse backgrounds and pursue musical careers outside the orchestra. In spite of a devoted cult following throughout the world, the group have performed very rarely in this country since their formation over 10 years ago.
Telephone and Rubber Band came about by a... initially, I was making a phone call upstairs here, and I got an engaged tone and a dialing tone at the same time. And basically, it makes quite a nice riff. I mean, it's the engaged tone comes across as a straight four, and the ringing tone actually, as I've often thought before that, it actually seems to be a kind of five-four time when you hear the ringing. You know, it's kind of one, two, three, four, five, one, two. Then I made a tape loop out of the telephone and put it on a multi-track machine. And then the next thing I did was, I'd been playing around with this chair, which I'll pull this chair over. This is my electric chair. And basically it's an ordinary chair with a contact microphone on it and a rubber band on the back here, you see. And it plugs into the amplifier, and actually it makes quite a nice sort of bass instrument, you see. And I'll just put this out of the way. And that was the bass instrument I used. I recorded that onto the telephone, which is on tape, and that was the basic track. And then I added violins or whatever. And so it's called Telephone and Rubber Band. Malicia Blanca. Malicia. Malicia Blanca.
Thank you. If you drink that much?
You're right.
It's
a bit too much.
There we go. Well, that's absolutely more like it.
That's a bit more like it.
Absolutely.
So that is the amount of Jack that I'm going to drink before this concert.
Thank you.
And this glass?
This glass is for Julio.
You know that kind of warmth that that occurs at a concert? In this concert, with because we had to have a live audience here, we're not just playing in the studio, and it ended up with this sort of relationship, a feeling of warmth, which ultimately, I suppose, is happily what our music generates, and that is, I suppose, in a sense, the Penguin Cafe. I wouldn't want to say that's it, limit it to that, but I would say that that's certainly a sign of the Penguin Cafe. I wasn't too clear until recently why it was penguins at all in the first place. And I think I've traced it to a documentary I saw on television. And I just remember it made a tremendous impact. It was about penguins in the Antarctic. And it's very crowded, a bit like, you know, London. And there was a penguin making his nest out of stones, going away for miles, bringing stone back, putting it on his nest, going away again. And then there was another penguin in the nest next door. When the other one went away to get a stone, he just leaned over and take a stone out of this other one's nest. And there were two distinct characters there. And there were a lot of their behaviour. You could see somehow ourselves reflected in it somehow. And it was something to do with that, I think, in retrospect. It was something to do with seeing our original nature, how we must have been before we started thinking an awful lot and screwing things up, you know. This next piece has two optional titles. You can choose between them. One is numbers 1, 2, 4, and the other one is numbers 1 to 4. Hang on. in a sense, I revolted very young against classical music. I was amusical, you know, no musical sign at all. But when I found a guitar, that was it. There was a sort of great connection with that. And then I proceeded to, I sort of half-heartedly went to a music college. I studied classical guitar and dropped out of the music college because of the academic, for me, the deadness of the academic teaching. This was 1968 or 9, after all. And I joined an avant-garde guitar group and got very involved in avant-garde music, which eventually I couldn't quite handle. It was a bit over complex and didn't give me the kind of emotional thing I needed for music, and I went on looking and I got involved in rock music a bit, and that didn't quite have the musical sophistication. I then in early 70s started listening to African music a lot, which was the most inspiring thing to listen to for a long time for me. Actually, it sounded like the music of home. It sounded more familiar than and more meaningful than Mozart, which is quite an odd kind of situation, but that's how it was. And I learnt a lot, or relearnt a lot, from listening to African music then. And I've ended up really discovering that what I did was, when I rejected classical music, I kind of threw the baby out with the bathwater and turned my back on actually what is really our strongest or our major tradition musically, and that is classical music. It's the major musical art form of our culture. And so having sort of looked around the world and wished I was sort of South American or whatever, Russian or something, in fact, I'm sort of actually of this culture, and that I've come back to where I started. I'm a kind of, what would you call it, a refugee almost. And here I am in the Penguin Cafe, which is my refound home, you know.
Thank you.
I don't know what they call it in Italian, but it's an offer we can't refuse. Another piece.
Thank you. Jeffrey, can you hear me well enough?
Yes. No, I'm not playing.
Yes, quite. No, I'm just making sure that...
No, I can hear that.
It's obviously getting there.
It's very good.
Right.
Piece written by Giles Farnaby, who lived in London around 1640, well, died in London in 1640, and this is his piece called Giles Farnaby's Dream, which we've tacked a few things onto it, I reckon. I don't think he'd mind. And again, thanks very much. This has been really...